بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم السلام عليكم brothers and sisters welcome back to another episode another part of our discussion about the major sins now today we're going to be discussing something that has a very very wide berth a wide topic And under it are many, many different components, in a sense an umbrella for many, many different major sins. And that is consuming wealth that is acquired unlawfully. And we touched upon this subject already briefly when we were talking about khamr, about wine, about the sales of intoxicants, and the prohibition of a person taking the money from wine that is sold, and that how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has cursed a person who sells khamr. So let's look to the Quran and see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. And in Surah Al-Baqarah, which of course is the second chapter or the surah of the Quran, in the 188th ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, the meaning of which is, and do not consume your wealth amongst each other in falsehood. Don't consume the wealth amongst yourself in falsehood. Now look what Abdullah ibn Abbas said. Abdullah ibn Abbas, of course, was the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and very famous for his understanding and insight into the Qur'an and explaining its verses. And he, radiallahu anhu, said, that is to say, by taking a false oath by means of which a person appropriates the wealth of his brother unjustly. Consuming wealth in falsehood has two aspects. One, taking it unjustly through usurpation, treachery, or theft, and two, taking it for sport or gaming, such as gambling or betting and the like. So there is a lot of various things that are covered here under this one topic. All of these are concerning acquiring wealth in an illegal manner. Amongst the greatest and the worst of those ways in which a person can acquire wealth unlawfully are those people, those tyrants, those rulers who take from people unlawful and unjust taxes. Now, we want to make a distinction between those taxes that are gathered, in a sense, by the consensus of people in order to bring some benefit to the society, and those taxes which are gathered unjustly by various governments and tyrannical governments and rulers. Although I'm sure a lot of us today may begin to even wonder where the line is, the amount of taxes that are being charged in various places. But the point is, all of this taking of wealth unjustly is amongst the major, major sins in Islam. And I think, obviously, from a social standpoint, from the point of view of society, from the point of view of human life, of human interaction, it is entirely obvious, and you'll find that throughout history, it is something that universally human beings have recognized, that things such as unjustly taking wealth, robbery, theft, highway robbery, and those type of things are all considered to be amongst the most serious crimes, and should be quite rightly amongst the most severely punished crimes. In Islam, there is nothing except an extremely severe and harsh punishment, and so it should be, for the theft, which is removing the hand off the thief. And why is the punishment so severe? We have to make something very clear, brothers and sisters. In Islam, this is not a punishment that is there merely for someone, for example, who is really hungry or who has some desperate need, and in order to fulfill that need, they had to steal something. Nor is it for something that is stolen, that is maybe just lying around, like some apples or some fruit that may be there on the stool. No, the punishment is not applied for that. The punishment is for the theft of an item of considerable value. It needed some type of cunning or some type of guile or some type of intention and effort to take it. So not stuff that just happens to be lying around unsecured, for example. So really, when a person does this, this goes against the very grain of the whole idea of a civilized society, of the rules by which and through which people can live together with trust. And this is what it is about. if stealing and theft and robbery and highway robbery and things like this become commonplace, then distrust and chaos and difficulty spreads throughout the whole of the society. And this is something we are increasingly observing in Western societies, who, although they claim they have humane punishments for these crimes, in reality, we find that the result of it, in terms of protecting society, is very minimal. In fact, criminals seem to get away with very, very little punishment. They return to society having spent time in prison, they re-offend, they commit more crimes. In fact, they've only been more versed in crime from their time in prison because they meet other prisoners who teach them better how to commit crime. And what happens? The society begins to descend into more chaos. It also means that we are less trusting. We are less ready to leave our doors open in our houses, to let people into our houses. Trust disappears amongst the people. Then people are divided, hostility occurs. The side effects, the negative side effects are many, and it goes on and on. So no wonder that Allah in His wisdom has instituted a very, very harsh punishment for such terrible crimes that have such a massive negative effect on society in general, not merely on the person from whom that object is being stolen, but really the impact is widespread. So what we were mentioning, that acquiring something by a false oath, this is also a major sin in Islam, to swear falsely, to swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to take Allah as a witness, to make an oath, and through that and by that you wish to acquire something that does not belong to you. This of course is just another form of theft, although, and the punishment for that is not the legalized, prescribed punishment of having the hand chopped off, but still, in reality, it is a type of major sin, it is a type of theft, it is a type of deception, and again, it is something that has negative effects not only on the individuals, but also on the whole society as well. And many other things we mentioned, for example, usurpation, treachery, and also through gambling, which is also, as we know, forbidden in the religion of Islam. So the one who wins money through gambling, that money is unlawful for them. That money is haram. Whoever acquires money through deception, through stealing, through con tricks, through swearing falsely, through, you know, false promises, any of these things, that money is haram. Whoever earns money through selling something is haram. That money is forbidden. And what is the consequence of that, brothers and sisters? That's what we want to talk about today. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in a narration that was narrated by Abu Hurairah, and he gave the example in a very important hadith, and most of us probably will be familiar with this. A man makes a long journey in a disheveled and dusty state, raises his hands to heaven, saying, "My Lord, my Lord, Rabbi, Rabbi," he says, "My Lord, my Lord," although his food, his drink, and his clothing are haram. They are from haram sources, and he is nourished from what is forbidden, from what is haram. How can such a person's supplication be answered? Muslim collected it. This is an indication, my brothers and sisters, that if the means through which you acquire those things, the money which you use to buy your clothes, your food, your drink is unlawful, then, or you consume unlawful food, which is also a major sin in Islam, which we'll be talking about, inshallah, then obviously your clothing, your food, your drink is haram. It affects you spiritually. It affects your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not accept your prayers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is in risk and a possibility and a strong possibility that Allah will not accept your dua. He will not respond to your supplication. And what a calamity that is. Because how much we need and depend upon Allah to listen to our prayers and to respond to our supplications. But if your money is haram, then it affects your supplication, your dua. And we seek refuge, with Allah from a supplication that is not responded to. May Allah protect us from that. Also, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, people who are busy with unjustly acquiring Allah's wealth will deserve the fire on the day of resurrection. Bukhari collected it. And also the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Anas, O Anas, earn good food lawfully, then your supplication will be answered, because if a man raises one bite of unlawful food to his mouth, his supplication will not be answered for 40 days. Similar, as we mentioned, to the person who drinks khamr. In a very beautiful hadith, and this is collected by Bayhaqi and Ahmed in their sunnans, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah has distributed your personality traits among you, just as He has distributed your provisions among you. And Allah bestows worldly goods upon those whom He likes and upon those whom He does not like. But He does not bestow the religion except on those whom He likes. And I like those to whom Allah has given the religion. No man acquires unlawful wealth and gives some of it in charity, except that it will not be accepted from him. He will receive no blessing for it. And if he leaves some of it behind for his descendants, it will be his provision in the fire. Brothers and sisters, the way you earn your livelihood is what makes you the person you are. That defines you. Your livelihood defines you. And this is what is very important from a type of psychological and sociological perspective, is that the thing that you spend your life pursuing, the thing that you spend your life doing, it makes you the person you are. If you spend your life cheating and stealing and acquiring money and food and drink or whatever it may be from people unjustly, that defines you. It defines who you are. It defines completely what you become. How then can you expect, when you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, having oppressed and tyrannized and cheated and stolen and deprived others of their hard-earned work, how can you expect the mercy and the forgiveness of Allah? How could you expect anything except a harsh treatment from those people whom you have oppressed and done wrong to? So brothers and sisters, it's very careful. We should be so careful about how we earn our wealth. And right at the beginning of this series, we mentioned the saying of Ibn Umar, it is more preferable to me that I should refrain from eating 1/6 of a dinar in what is unlawful than giving 100,000 dinars in lawful money. It is better to keep away from even a little bit of haram than giving thousands of amounts of money in what is even halal. So brothers and sisters, think about that. Think deeply about that. This is stressing how important it is to make sure that your money, that your life, that your earning, that your livelihood is halal. Even if it is little, brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is His provision. He will give it benefit. He will give it barakah. He will give it blessing if you only, subhanAllah, believe in Allah and make sure that your money is from lawful means. So Ibn Umar, he reported from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as saying, the world is sweet and green, and whoever earns wealth from lawful means and spends it in the right way, Allah will reward him with paradise. And whosoever earns wealth from it through unlawful means and spends it in the wrong way, Allah will admit him to the place of disgrace, meaning hellfire. Most probably he was deeply involved with his desires for forbidden things, and consequently he will end in the fire. Also the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if a person does not care how he earns his wealth, Allah will not care by which gate he admits him into the hellfire. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from his hellfire and from his punishment. Also Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu said, it's better for a person to put dirt in his mouth than to put something haram into it. It is better for a person to put dirt into his mouth than to put something haram into it. Whether it is haram food like pig or carrion or something that is sacrificed to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or any type of intoxicant or something else that may be forbidden, whether it is literally something haram or that it is unlawful due to the way in which that thing was acquired and that was earned. It's better to eat dust, to eat dirt, than eat from what is haram. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said. Yusuf ibn Isbat said, when a young man stands up for worship, shaitan tells his associate to find out the source of his food. If his source of food is bad, he tells them to leave him alone with his pleadings and exertions, because his own self is sufficient against him. His own nafs is enough against him. What is his prayer? What is his dua? What is it? No. Shaitan knows that if this person is earning money from what is haram, then this person, his own nafs is enough to destroy him. What is at the heart of this, brothers and sisters? You see, it is not only merely about earning haram things and contributing to the ill and the destruction and the corruption of society. And we should think about meeting Allah with that on the Day of Judgment. Not only the sin of having earned what is haram, but also the consequence of leading to corruption of society. And all of that is going to be on our negative scales on the Day of Judgment. All of that will be weighed for us. No. But also the effect of it, brothers and sisters, we want to think about the other side of it. We want to think about the spiritual side of it. So in reality, what does this show? It shows that you do not believe that Allah is your provider. If you have to end up earning money that is haram, you don't really believe that your rizq, your provision has been written for you. Because what is going to come to you is going to come to you. Whatever Allah has decreed and written for you, from food and from drink and from provision, it's going to come to you. It has to come to you. You cannot die except that the provision has to come to you. So when you go and you seek that provision that Allah has decreed for you, and you seek it in an unlawful way, it is in reality an illustration of the fact that you do not truly trust in Allah. You do not truly trust your Creator. You do not truly believe that He is your provider. You do not truly recognize the fact that He is your Lord and He will care for you. If you are His servant, if you are His slave, do you think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will leave you? Do you think He will abandon you? Of course He will not. He will care for you. But as we mentioned at the beginning, life is a test. Allah told us in the Quran, life is a test. All of this is to see, how will you behave? What will you do? Will you obey Allah or will you disobey Allah? Will you earn your money through what is halal or will you earn your money through that which is haram? So shaitan says, don't bother this one. Is his money haram? Don't bother. His nafs is enough for him. So a man who makes a long journey, so we mentioned this, and when he says, Ya Rabb, Allah is not going to, subhanahu wa ta'ala, is not listening to his dua, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not listening to his prayers. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that each morning and each evening in the Bayt al-Maqdis in Jerusalem, the angel announces, Allah does not accept either the voluntary or the obligatory worships of a person who eats what is forbidden and what is acquired unlawfully. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that. And in another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when a person performs hajj with unlawful money and calls out, labbaik Allahumma labbaik, which means, here I am, O Lord, here I am. The angel says, no, here I am. For you, no happiness there is. Your hajj is rejected and thrown back to you. Subhanallah, this is what the angels say to that person who is making hajj from haram money. You can't get evil. You can't get good from what is evil, brothers and sisters. All you get from evil is more evil. Subhanallah, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Earn your money from what is halal. Earn your money from halal means, even if it is little, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless it and multiply it and increase it and give you blessings that you can't even imagine. And Wahab ibn Ward, he said, A beautiful saying. Even if you stand firm like an arrow or a ship's mast, it will not benefit you unless you are careful of what you put in your stomach with regard to whether it is earned lawfully or not. And Ibn Abbas said, Allah does not accept the fard prayer of a person in whose stomach there is unlawfully earned food until he turns to Allah in repentance. And the Sufyan al-Thawri, he said, the one who spends unlawful wealth in charity is like a person who cleans his clothes with urine. Clothes are not cleaned except with water. And sins are not erased except by that which is permissible. And Omar said, we used to leave off 9/10 of what is permissible due to fear of its being contaminated with that which is haram. And I want to leave you with another story, a beautiful story that from Abu Bakr. And Abu Bakr had a slave girl, and this slave girl bought to him what she had earned. And Abu Bakr asked her, where did you get this? And he used to always ask her, where did you get it? If he was satisfied with the reply, he would eat it, meaning if she'd earned it from a halal way, he would eat the food, and if not, he would leave it alone. Anyway, one night the slave bought some food, and Abu Bakr, who was fasting, he forgot to ask the slave the usual question and took a bite of it. And then he remembered, and he said to the slave, where did you get this? And the slave replied, I acted as a fortune teller for some people in the days of ignorance, and not being good at it, I deceived them. One of them met me and gave me the food. And Abu Bakr said, woe be to you, you deceived me in order to destroy me. And then he put his hand in his mouth and made himself vomit. Someone told him to drink water first, and he drank some water and then made himself sick, and it came from his stomach. And he was told by those who were present, may Allah have mercy upon you. All this just for one bite. He replied, if it had not come out, I would have thrown it out even with my breath. I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, a body which has grown out of what is haram is only fit for the fire. Consequently, I became fearful that this bite might contribute to the growth of my body. This was the fear of Allah of those companions. Brothers and sisters, the door of Tawbah is always open. Repent to Allah. If your money is haram, if your earnings are haram, give it up and earn what is halal from today, brothers and sisters. Make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Repent to Him, change your ways, and open to yourself the gates of goodness in this life and the next. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.